My name is Enrique, I work for Igalia, and today I'm going to talk about Media Source Extensions on Webkit using GStreamer. So, what's the information on the Media Source Extensions and what they are? Which is written in HTML, is, as you can see in the slide. So it's a special tag that you can configure with a URL that hosts some kind of network, a media for instance, and then you specify the type. And then there is some JavaScript API to start playback and yeah, that playing the movie. But this tag has some limitations. That is that the media you want to play and that's limited. I mean, there are some use cases that are not appropriate for this limitation. So, to overcome that, the W3C has created a new addition, which is the blob view, which is a special kind of JavaScript object that you, which you can supply coming from other sources, coming from JavaScript or from local files stored in special places. And then you can configure the media tab with that special blob URL so that it can get the movie from alternative sources. But still, that's not enough because use cases such as adaptive streaming and time shift, there are some limitations. Adaptive streaming is a technique which consists on selecting a specific version of the video, of the same video, with different quality depending on the network conditions. So if you are on a RAP network, it's going to choose a video with poor quality, and if you are on a network, it's going to choose a video with better quality. And that quality change cannot be achieved only using the blob view. So, some kind of system to let JavaScript the data that it considers to the player, and then the player can play the movie. And this is what Media Source Extensions provide. Media Source Extensions is a standard that is defined by the W3C, and this is the URL you can access to it and see how it's specified. And basically, it allows, as I said, it lets JavaScript to generate video data and to feed it to the player dynamically. Yep. And also provides more control on the player state. JavaScript can know if the player has enough data to start the video, what data is buffering at this moment, and depending on that information, can take decisions. So, if you are an HTML programmer, how do you use anything? Basically, MSC is an API for JavaScript, and the most important, one of the most important elements is the HTML media element. This is a C++ class which maps to the video tag that JavaScript can see. And then there is also a blob object in C++ that encapsulates blob views. And the source of objects exposed to JavaScript. Media source is like, well, it's a special source, a special object that can be encapsulated in a blob URL and can provide data to the player. But Media Source itself does nothing. What it is to create like child objects, which are the source buffer, and each of the source buffer is a way to introduce data, to append data to the video in a different way. In this example, we see the audio element or the video element, which is in HTML. We see that it has a blob URL, and inside it encapsulates a media source, and this media source has two source buffers. Then what JavaScript can do is to append data to one of the source buffers, and that data is passed directly to the media player. The media player can process it, and finds what timestamps, what samples are inside of that data, and those timestamps are exposed from the media source to the JavaScript world. So JavaScript can know what is buffered and what not. So this is a small example, very simple, in HTML and JavaScript. And what you see here is first a video tag, and then some JavaScript code. What this code does is first to get a reference to the video tag, then it creates a media source object, and then we're going to skip this block, and then it translates the media source into a blog URL object, and to finish the video tag with that special URL. And then all of this, everything is asynchronous. So what we do is to define here an event listener to, for the source open event that is going to happen as soon as we configure the video tag with the object. So when the event is called, our function is executed, and this function, what it does is to tell the source buffer to, tell the media source to create two source buffers, one of type video on before, and another of type audio on before. And then you can issue several calls to on each of those source buffers to the append data function and supply the data. This data is usually stored on represent JavaScript as a byte array. There is a type in JavaScript that can hold byte arrays, so you can fill that array with whatever you want, and you can to fill it, you can synthesize it on your own, or you can call HTTP request and get that information from an external URL and then get the array from that request and append it to a source buffer or any way you want. So all of this, this is how it's used. Something important I forgot is that when you append the data to the source buffers, as I said before, the data is pre-processed and is demuxed internally and is scanned, and depending on what is in that data, some special objects, well, some special tracks appear. That data can hold an audio track, a video track, or a text track. Yeah. So how is all of this implemented? This is a bit daunting, but don't worry. All these things that are accessible from JavaScript are actually mapped to some C++ object internally inside WebKit. And as part of the framework, it has two parts. One multi-platform part, which is common to the Apple port, and to our WebKit GTK and WPA ports. And then one port specific part, which I will explain later. So the most important here, the main idea, the most important is HTML video element, which is the C++ mapping the audio tag or the video tag, which can have subclasses. And this media element has a media player, which is the object implementing the actual media playback inside of the browser. This media player is a multi-platform class, to a platform specific implementation. For that, it defines an interface, and then you have several platform implementations. The one relevant here is Media Player Private GStreamer MC, which is the implementation that uses GStreamer to achieve the functionality that the model provides. This on one hand. But on the other hand, we have the Media Source class, right? And a Media Source class can, an auxiliary object, which is a source buffer list, can hold several source buffers. And each source buffer can find several track buffers. Several tracks hold in a audio, video, or text track list, which hold audio, video, or text tracks. And then each track has a platform dependent implementation in the form of track private streamer. So the media source has a platform implementation, which is this one, the media source streamer. The source buffer also has a platform implementation. And what happens is that the data from JavaScript goes to the source buffer, and the source buffer relies on the platform implementation to preprocess that data. And the platform implementation, what happens is talks to the player, and the player holds several auxiliary objects that perform the preprocessing. And with all that data, the source buffer forwards the samples that it has found and the timestamp 70 to the upper layer, and in that way it's available to JavaScript. And all the data that has been processed is stored in memory for JavaScript to use. The processing is done, well, the algorithm or the structs are generated, and they are also stored in memory. Then, suppose that you have preprocessed those appends, you have some buffer brain machine, and JavaScript decides to start, decides that it's the player the position that it wants to play, so it starts the player. Starts the player by calling to a playback method, so calling one method here. This method actually tells the media player to start the data, the media player relies on the platform specific implementation, and this platform specific implementation has a player which is in charge of the actual player of the data. This player, well, also there are some relations and the superclasses used in order for other features and so on. So there is a plugin to perform the playback and so on. But basically, when you start the playback, this data is inserted in a playback album using a special object, a special element, which is the Webkit media source that I'm going to describe next. So, to reach all of this, this is how we have the integration now, but to reach this point, we tried several times in the past, and we found several pitfalls and have to rework our work until we reach a good implementation. So, our first attempt, what we did, was to process everything in the same timeline, in the same, well, which is what before was the only one that existed for that video. We use a plugin as top container. That plugin has as input has a unidecode bin which is in charge of getting the data and decode it. As only configuring a special that was the only element that could was our working media source and not another distinct element. So our working media source is instantiated, and then here I have elements to do the pre-processing that I explained before. First, remember that each source buffer, so we are going to have the source buffer generate tracks. So we are going to have one mini per source buffer, right? And that's why here there are two mini pipelines, one for video and one for audio. And each of those pipelines, the app source, then it finds what type is in the data, and if it's not of the expected type, then it triggers an error. And then we have qt_max that is in charge of the max in that data. Qt_max can find itself several streams, several tracks. That's in theory, but in practice, for our main use case, which is YouTube back, YouTube TV, usually there is only one track so far. So now we have the track, the data is flowing here, we have a mini queue to store the data, and in case, as I said, we don't support, but we would like to support in the future. In the hypothetical case that there were several tracks, we need the synchronization, that's why we use a mini queue. And after the video, there is a parser that fills the gaps in the 6264 information, that there are some gaps that need to be filled by the parser. And then the data can go directly into the next part of the original decoder, which are the decoder, one in the decoder and one on the decoder. We get raw data here, and that data goes to a play sync. Well, in the case of audio, it goes to the audio sync, and in the case of video, it goes to a special WebKit video sync element that is highly coupled with WebKit and is in charge of getting the surfaces or the EGL surfaces special to go to the compositor and so on. But this first implementation, what I said, the same plugin, one stream per source buffer, and also thing here, which is that stage, right before the playback. To the working layer in the JavaScript world. And to do that analysis, because you don't want to consume the data immediately. You only want to consume the data when the JavaScript page starts to play, not when the data is appended. So what we did was to place a probe here at the output of the master, and with this probe we store the data. We take the buffers and send them to the applications, and the buffers disappear. They are not here anymore. So and then when the web layer decides that they actually must start, then it takes the buffers from them and redirects them here, channel to the path, and then they flow the path in the pipeline. This first version was hard-coded to keep demands, and this means that can only support MP4 as container, and usually we only have H.264 and audio and depth encoding for the data. As I told, we just place it for the rendering of the video and all the data, and this approach has some limitations. The append buffer operation and the playback are not independent, and this is very bad, especially for 6. Because when you do the first thing that we have to have to interpret here is that in order for the preprocessing to work, the playback needs to be in paused state or changing the pause, because that's the only way to generate a pre-rolling, and pre-rolling is the stage by which data tries to reach the sinks. They will never reach the sinks by the moment, but it's the only way to have everything flow in front of them. So that's a problem, and especially it's a problem when you do a sink, because when you do a sink, the sink operations need a whole flash of the whole pipeline. But what happens if you are in the middle of an append operation of a preprocessing, and you in the playback side you need to do a sync? The is to stop in the middle, packets and packets, and it's not successful. So this is a problem. And at that moment, we realize that we need to change this model. All the folders are a problem because to do a sync, the common thing to do is to run the streamer sync, the GST element sync code, and that will fast that will change the target position to a new position, and then you insert the new data and everything works smoothly. But here, in MC, to perform syncs, what you usually do is to first from time 0 to time 5 seconds, and then you want to sync to time 100. Then what you would do would be to start a for time 100, but maybe while you are still playing on 0 to 5 seconds. And it's more that the maps didn't behave very well, and we also need to change some things. At some point you can see backwards, and you can start appending data which is from a previous position than the one that you are playing, so that's tricky. So in a second attempt, we move the preprocessing part to we speed the pipeline model, and we move the preprocessing part to several append pipelines, one versus buffer. Each of these append pipelines has an app source, the type find, the key maps, and upsync, and they are limited to one kind of to one track, to one track per source buffer, and to control the append operation, and in order, as all of this is asynchronous, if the append operation doesn't finish properly, then JavaScript never gets notified of the finishing of the append operation, and never receives the event, and then the JavaScript it keeps waiting forever for that operation to complete. So the operation completes no matter what. And that's why we use this state machine. We start in the not started state. Then suppose that you fake the headers of the video, what is going to happen is that, you're going to have a chance to run around, and as if you at the headers, the track are already created, but we want to have something. So it's going to change to the data start state, and then not started, and then the event has finished. Then you do another event that does have samples, that has real video. So it's going to start with not started, go to ongoing, go to sampling, iterate here once per buffer, and once per sample as found by the deduction, and then change to last sample and not start. And at any moment, the JavaScript code can decide to stop the operation, to abort it. So what it does is to set a flag to true, but we cannot perform this scheme at the moment, because that would break things, and that would happen. So So what we do is that we complete the process model, but we change, for instance, here from data start, we change temporarily to abort, clean everything, and then to not start it. Or if we were something, we change to abort, clean everything, and then not start. And if we are not doing anything, but somebody requests an abort, then we go to abort and not start. And then we have the playback pipeline, which corresponds to the show in the first attempt. But now it's simpler. We still have the data source, but it's simpler now. You have the sources and the parsers, and then the rest is the same, the decode beans and the seeks. So with all of this, we found some simple special cases which need special attention on our side. For instance, regarding qtmax and append buffer, we found that the MSC API, as it is defined, it only allows binary data in the appends. It allows JavaScript to specify any information about what data is being appended. JavaScript can go from second 100 to second 105. That's not possible. It only can append binary data, and then it's up to qtmax to maximize more. So it has to be dynamax in qtmax. This is not a problem with sequential appends, because you append a chunk of data, qtmaxer does its job, you append the next data, qtmaxer can continue from there and keep generating timestamps sequentially, and there's no problem. But as I told before, with out-of-order sending appends, qtmax becomes a little crazy and doesn't know what to do, and then generating sequential timestamps when it should start generating timestamps from some other point of the timeline. So we need two bugs in Boxer. The first one is to use the track from atom in MP4. It specifies the decode of that fragment of MP4. And it was not being called in all the cases, so we changed that, and now no matter what we append, it's going to produce the right timestamps. And this enables out of order appends. This was a bug which corrected a small problem, but it's not very important. And the second thing that we needed to take into account was how to detect the append processing, because the thing is designed to do a linear playback and show what it plays and everything. But in this case, we are doing the processing. And at some point, we need to know when qtmax has finished. It has processed all the frames and is not waiting for more, and we should notify the upper layer. In the first time, we tried it in a cool way, which is using plots to see when a buffer is traversing is being loaded from qtmax, and then to set up a lot. So when there were more buffers in some time, then we concluded that the append operation had finished. But this was a very way of doing it, and then we found a right way, which is that a source can emit a special kind of signal, which is the need data signal, when it needs more data from the application because the next element had finished the processing. So we subscribe to this signal, and when we receive more data, that means that the operation has finished, and we need to tell the JavaScript world about that. We have to take into account several things regarding adaptive streaming. What is adaptive streaming actually in the end? Adaptive streaming is nothing more than a change of cuts on the fly. So first you have value, for instance, in low quality, and up to some moment you start to have value in higher quality. What happens when this happens, or at least what happened in the later versions of the streamer, when qtmax removed the old paths with the old caps and created new paths with new caps. So we, in the append pipeline, we did to reattach the remoxer to the absent. Is complex because in the hypothetical case that you have a connection with several internal tracks, if one track disappears and another one is created, you don't know if that new one is replacing the other one, or is a completely new track that has appeared and have nothing to do with the existing ones. So To properly solve this, we need proper track ID support by Qtmax, but this is not, I think this is not ready or became ready very recently. So what we do is to specify and assume that only one track could come from its source buffer, so that if a new track appears, it means that it's the old one that is being regenerated, and we only need to reattach. And then our customer has some things that we need to have into account. For our customer, we does an optimization because it thinks, okay, maybe I have preprocessed from 10 seconds to 10 seconds, I am doing the playback, and when I am at 10 or 3 seconds, then the browser decides that we can display a higher quality. It gets the higher quality, it gets from 0 to 10 in higher quality. But what Webkit wants to do is to flash and forget about audio. What the browser does is to tell, okay, let's flash everything. Let's start the higher quality data so that the user can start enjoying the higher quality data from as soon as possible. This from the streamer is a problem because the streamer is very well designed for a full playback flash, but it's not driven to do a partial flash still in the pipeline. But what Webkit wants is a partial flash and reinvent the data. So which is that we get the current position of the playback, we manually insert flash start and flash stop events in that stream of the pipeline, and then we abuse a GST-based source new single segment to generate a new segment from the new position that is to receive the higher quality data. Until infinity, for instance, or until the duration. But we also found that the segment generated by source using this API doesn't to use. So we attach a segment fixer probe at the end of source, and we fix the segment to have the times that we really want, and at that point, is that the video stream and the audio stream both have the same segment. The audio stream has the segment that it had before because it never changed the quality, and the video stream has a new segment that we have delayed that is 100% compatible with the one of the audio stream. And this makes the stream synchronizer element happy, so that we can still keep synchronizing the buffers properly because it has a proper segment. And then this is when it happens in the stream. But when it happens in the audio stream, we try to do the same, but didn't succeed very well. So what we did is that we do no flash. We just inject the new data, even if it's repeated, if it has been injected before in lower quality. And we just have the decoder and the sync to ignore the data that is repeated until a data that is really new reaches the decoder of the sync, and then it's displayed. And then the most critical part, which is the sync. In a regular video, the streamer is in charge of all of the whole sync operation. But here in Webkit, it needs some cooperation by the browser, by the Webkit layer. So we need to coordinate the Webkit and the streamer layers. And all of this happens asynchronously. So this is even more difficult. So the first thing we need to do when we want to do a sync is to wait until the data for the target position is buffered, is available. It's pointless to try to sync because there is no data to play for the new position. But when the data is available, then we can sync on the streamer side. We do a GST element sync on the playback pipeline. Now we must coordinate how the data for the new position is inserted into the player. To the player pipeline. For that, the media source waits until all the app sources of all the streams have received the sync data signal, and then waits after all the app sources have received the data signal. And when that is accomplished, then we we can act, we are actually ready to provide the new data to the pipeline. To do that, we talk to the Media Source object so that it can seek. And this means that Media Source calls to a function which is provide media data that and actually provides the new data to the pipeline, and the seek is completed. And all of these operations can happen, they don't need to necessarily happen in this order. They can happen in different order, and we need to contemplate all the cases. So, the final result of all this implementation is this, that I can, I'm going to display in a video, because I, well, I really trust the Wi-Fi. So here we are going to YouTube TV, which is a special version of YouTube, crafted for set-top boxes and televisions. We load a video. Okay, so when the video starts, JavaScript is going to append data under the hood. So it's going to fetch data from the network. It's going to append it, and that data is going to generate buffer ranges. So you have a buffer here that can be queried by JavaScript. Well, it's played. And at some point, you can perform seeks. And as you see, the seeks are working properly. And this shows that it works properly. And also, it's playing at 1080p, a 30 frames per second. This is on desktop. But we also have on an embedded device, on a Raspberry Pi, and that's the demo that is outside, so you can have a look. Stop it, okay. So what's going to happen from now on? What's our future work? First, we because Webkit is an alive project, and from time to time, participants change the code and make our platform implementation to fix it. Then we also need to provide web support, because this YouTube web application that I showed, in order for the manufacturers to get a certification for it, they need to comply with a set of tests that changes every year. And for the year 2018, which is the next round of certification, they require all the routers to support whatever with BB9 and Opus decoders. So we are working on that, because we were on it before. At some point, we need to support multiple streams versus buffer, because the three C tests require it, and we are having a lot of failures because we don't support this. And then you can access the source code. This is the source code of Webkit GDK, and then also which is for desktop, and then also WPE, which is a different flavor of Webkit, but especially designed for embedded devices running in full screen and with hardware acceleration. And also, the version of WPE, for instance, on the Raspberry, takes advantage of the open source drivers, and so it's able to do hardware acceleration with zero copies and get the video in 1080p at 30 frames per second, and very well. Nothing more. If you have any question. Yeah.
So YouTube obviously sometimes uses MSE, or the other big. Are other people using
MSE extensions? Oh, yes, of course. He asked that YouTube uses MSE, but if there were other actors on the platform, it's not also MSE. Yes, MSE is going to be used by the main media providers out there in the internet, but there are special use cases that are interesting, which is that there are several players, I think they are open source, or at least they are freely available, such as dash.js, which is an implementation of MPEG dash. There is also hls.js, which is an implementation of HLS. And I think there are other like commercial or semi-commercial players that also use MSE. One advantage of this MSE that I recommend is that before MSC, the other way to support, to provide Dash was that the panel itself needed to be very complex and needed to support Dash internally. And for months, the steamer does that, so it's able to do that, so that was not a problem. But having MSC, you can get rid of all that complexity and move part of that complexity to the JavaScript world.
Annoying if you've already done that.
I know. But well, in the other hand, if you have only one, it's annoying. But maybe tomorrow a new problem appears, and then you are going to save the work in your stream. And because if you ask for it, then you need to have it. I mean, the set of boxes manufacturers need to have. So, any more questions? Yeah.
I saw you support seeking, and it's actually really good. But I was wondering, how do you handle iframes so that, or keyframes so you actually seek starting from an iframe?
Yes, he asked if how do we handle, how do we synchronize seek so that it copes with iframes and has proper synchronization? And the answer is that depends on the hardware, because there is some hardware that is not able to do what I'm going to explain now. So that in those special cases, we just tell the streamer to do a. But there are several seek flags when you do the seek operation in the streamer, and one of those flags can tell that no matter what time do you tell the streamer is going to snap to a near keyframe. So this is one way to do it. Is that we locate, the way we code is as it has the samples in memory and has the samples, it can locate the nearest previous sample to the point that you are seeking, so the nearest keyframe, and then it starts, and when you seek to the target position, it appends it, sorry, it fits starting from that sample. But there's the problem to actually seek to the accurate position so that the decoder needs all the frames to decode everything, but then the sync is smart enough to only start rendering from the target position. No questions? Yeah.
Do you deal with the append mode property for source buffer, the sequence and segment?
I don't think we support, because that is a.
Does the packet reordering, or does it by timestamp?
That kind of codes are more or less recent, and I don't think we support them. Any more questions? Okay, thank you. Thank you.